Penguin Random House Audio presents Mental, Lithium, Love, and Losing My Mind. This is the author, Jaime Lowe. For my parents, all of them. Part 1, Episode 1. Chapter 1, Paint the Ceiling with Me, and I will show you the secret tunnel to Neverland. Where is that nugget of old dried-up shitweed I bought on the Venice boardwalk 2 years ago from a vagrant dealer who may or may not have sold me a thimble full of dirt mixed with oregano? I pounded on the volume button of my Costco special Magnavox stereo. It was pulsating in syncopation with my anxiety. Cacophony doesn't describe it. It was so loud, I could feel it traveling from my heels to my outer cranium, taking in the itching, the scratching, the clawing, the gridlock of atonal chords. It was loud, and I needed it to be. I could feel the chorus like combat, and I could deflect the harmony. Angels and peace and major chords weren't welcome. Just the loud, cheap stereo behind my slammed shut door. Where was it? Where was it? Where? I knew it was somewhere. The chords crashed on top of each other. I could see them. I could see the waves of sound cascading from speaker to skin. I could taste them. It was not under my mattress or tucked into a corner of my pink floral Laura Ashley sheets, a present from my bat mitzvah. It was not in my jewelry box that my paternal grandparents, Oma and Opa, had given me when they traveled to Austria. The jewelry box, not the weed, had a tiny ballet dancer on a rusted metal gear that would spring to life and pirouette to canned music every time the lid was cracked. The lid was not cracked, and the tiny dancer was crushed under a different sound, suffocating. Where was the nugget? Where was the nugget? Where was that nickel bag of shit weed? I bought it. I smoked it once on a Friday afternoon when no one was home. I felt nothing but fire in my throat, swallowing red-hot embers. I was good. I was great. I was perfect all the time. But now I needed that chunk of bullshit weed so I could get out of this terrifying place with no windows, out of this castle of chords crashing down on me, a wall of terror collapsing onto my skull the way they had wanted it to. I had to get out, away from my tulip sheets, away from my delicate jewelry box, and very far away from my mask collection. The lips that moved in the night. It was subtle. I could see it. Those faces had something to say and would not shut the fuck up. I hear you now. I'm listening to you. I am leaving. The popcorn tin. It was in the popcorn tin. The tin that once held caramel, cheddar, and butter and sat next to a life-sized penguin in our living room. My things that no one needed to know anything about. Behind my tiny rocking chair and boo-boo bear. Stop looking at me, glass eye. I ripped off the tin lid. It smelled like popcorn. Small, stale kernels were wedged in around the edges. There was a folded up piece of material. It was the key to my escape. I unfolded the material carefully, like a curated item from a time capsule. And just like my vision, there was that shit brown weed, barely more than seeds and stems. There it was, right where I had stashed it, my dirt fucking weed. It was in that forest green tin, wrapped in that original Venice Beach baggie. I needed it now. It needed to be with me in my backpack. It needed to travel with me wherever I ended up. I could not leave without it. Essential item, essential survival, surviving, surviving this war with secret spies and reborn Nazis, and people in masks, people who refuse to take off their masks. I grabbed it, buried it in my backpack, and laid my full body weight on top of my dog, nature. My calm, calm, calming dog. Immune to emotion. She accepted my love like the weather. It was there. Nothing she could do about it but wait until it passed. I scratched behind her ears and above her tail. It wagged out of obligation and reflex. She had sad Labrador eyes and seemed empathetic to my plight. But she was indifferent. She didn't know war. She didn't know combat. She was even nice to the hissing opossum. She stood in front of the nocturnal beast, licking her nose with her wet pink tongue until, thwack, that asshole opossum sideswiped her snout with a fistful of daggers. Claws. Nature was my soulmate, my partner in sad and lonely. She could not wear a mask, and she could not throw a grenade or a gas bomb or knife. She had no opposable thumbs, so she was an ally. I could wiggle my nose in front of her wet muzzle, and she sat patiently, collapsing on all fours to sleep like temporary death had struck her. She was so calm. Where I was going, she could not go. She would be eaten alive, and maybe I would be too. I had to go. I don't know why I was chosen to move out. I don't know why they wanted me to leave, but I knew it was absolutely essential to say goodbye to nature, to escape the tightening parental grip of my controlling father, to run from the cascade of sound. My dad did not understand that Michael Jackson had communicated with me directly and that I knew of a direct tunnel to Neverland. A not necessarily safe place, but a place I could go if needed. A last resort. Neverland. When I saw Michael Jackson wore masks upon masks and would remove each one, revealing different faces, like a Russian doll shedding compartmental tiers of painted tiki. I grabbed the shitweed and filled my backpack with several small cameras to document atrocities. It was a JanSport back-to-school backpack with a leather bottom, another Costco special. I packed a change of clothes and papers I had been working on. My manifestos about Nicaragua and the Holocaust and the Muppets. Some drawings and diagrams. I did not leave the house quietly. Many doors slammed in my wake. I left my Magnavox stereo on. Waves of big guitars colliding. A tsunami of screeching sound. I was not communicating effectively with my dad. He did not understand anything. He yelled when I was suffocating in stereo. But now I wanted him to know I was gone, going, forever. Goodbye at age 16. My stepmom, Marilyn, was away at her stepdad's bar mitzvah in Chicago. He was too old to be bar mitzvahed, but I respected his newfound love of the Torah, of God, of ritual, of holiness. I believed so deeply in God that I did not think a book could hold the majesty. Not scrolls, not nothing. God had chosen me to be a savior and to be saved, which meant escape. And so I did. I ran out the side door screaming, my dad chasing me. I think he yelled. I yelled back. I was that song. I was screaming those guitars. I was signaling something. He grabbed my backpack. My backpack. And we struggled in the driveway near Marilyn's mustard yellow Volvo station wagon. I was a prisoner, held back, held against my will, trapped in a house, masked with shingles. Rights revoked, violated. Eventually I let go. The backpack didn't matter. Escape did. He opened the small pouch and saw a handful of keychains with cameras. No big deal. except for the keychain that contained the key to my Honda Civic hatchback. He took that key. He opened the big compartment and rifled through until he saw the folded material. He unfolded it and took my shit dirt weed. I screamed about unfairness and abuse. I needed my car, but I needed that shit dirt weed more. It was like an oracle. Magic leaves so.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.